Welcome to the STEM Professional Chat by iSTEM Care. The purpose of this interview is to bring career stories from STEM professional, which is from people from science, technology, engineering, and mathematics background who undertook or undertaking non-traditional career paths. And we hope that the career journey discussion with the professionals from STEM community will be helpful for students and early career professionals, or even professionals who are trying to navigate the career journey to craft your own career journey in future. So I am Pawan, and I'm joining with my colleague Vandita. And our guest is today is very special. She is Dr. Reema Day. Dr. Reema is PhD in Engineering Sciences from CSR Laboratory, National Meteorological Laboratory in India, and later she worked as a postdoc for 2 years in the same place. Prior to this, she worked with Apollo Tyres, General Electric as scientist in polymer engineering. Dr. Reema started her second inning of career as a confident personality coach, wherein she is on a mission to help people radiate confidence through their appearances, communication, and etiquettes. And today she is joining us to share her career journey from beginning with engineer, working in industry, and then going back to the PhD or academia, I would say, and now trying to venture out her own new venture in the career coaching sector. So thank you so much, Dr. Reema, for joining us today to share your career journey with us.
Thank you so much, Pawan, for giving me this opportunity. Thank you, Vandita, for the whole of the iSTEM Care team for giving me this opportunity to share my journey with all of you. Thank you.
Yeah, so your career journey is very interesting. It's like it's going on different directions and trying to forge or discover what a person wants to do. I think that's kind of career journey. So we would be kind of wanting to hear about, if you take a brief time, maybe 5-10 minutes, and just walk us through your career journey in brief, from being a student to how did you get into different jobs and how did you move into PhD, and now you're trying to explore a new career venture.
Okay, 5-10 minutes, that's a challenge, but I'll try to finish definitely in 5-10 minutes. So as a student, after my class 12, I scored the highest in English in my school. And there was a confusion between I should go in science or English. And obviously, majority voted for science, and majority, I mean, family members. And at that ripe age, obviously, I also decided I should go for science. And then I studied BTech, and then I was good in academia and BTech. I scored well, and then I got job in Apollo Tyres. I worked there for a year, came back for pursuing my MTech. And while I was pursuing my MTech, I got placed as an intern in General Electric, and then moved on to be placed as a scientist at General Electric. And it was during my journey as a scientist at General Electric that I discovered many other things about me, because it was a very challenging environment. And to thrive in that environment, you have to be really adaptive. So that is when I figured out that I have other qualities as well. One of them being people skills. I was really good at people skills, and that's the reason I had also got an inclusiveness award from GE. And followed by that, once I got married and me and my husband were trying to be at one place, and what finally worked out for us was me getting a scientist fellowship position at National Meteorological Laboratory, wherein I had to do my PhD in engineering, but in the arena of fatigue in metals, which was entirely new to me and very challenging, because it was a transition from polymers to fatigue in metals. However, initially, as challenges make you feel the fear, I was also very doubtful about myself. I may not be able to do it. But also during my PhD journey, I was pregnant. I lost my father to brain tumor. And also, I had a vitiligo problem, if you can see. I have patches now, right? So I have become all patchy and spotty during my whole journey of PhD. So psychologically, I was going through too much at the same time. There was good moments, there were bad moments, everything mixed. However, it ended up good. But while I was writing my thesis, I decided I'm not pursuing this anymore. But what I'm supposed to pursue, I didn't know that. So once I finished my thesis, I knew it had to be something in lines with communication. I got myself certified while working as an image consultant. And also I'm in the process of getting certified from Scottish Quality Authorizations in Soft Skills. And it took me 2 years to decide post my PhD that I should be in the field of communication. And that is when I started taking my baby steps. You know, 6 months prior to leaving the job, I started posting. I started taking pro bono sessions through the company. And as I realized that it's important right now for me to venture into this thing, I should devote my full time to it for me to make it a success. That's the reason I decided to quit my job. And right now, it's been 3 months that I quit my job, and I've already done almost 6 sessions with people across sectors, student across institutes in India, including IITs. And I have been speaking at many events. So that pretty much sums up my journey till now.
So it's really, I would say, very interesting career journey. And people would be surely finding it useful, because being an woman and then trying to, a girl especially, and trying to venture into different career options where the males are predominating, you must have encountered a lot of psychological barriers. So we would be kind of interested to know what were those barriers and if any, and how did you kind of try to overcome that?
Yeah. So as you pointed out rightly, being a woman, the diversity ratio of women in technology and sciences, diversity ratio of men is to women is really poor. And even the ministries are working hard to increase the diversity ratio. Coming back to what are the challenges I faced, I don't remember any challenge as such I faced, because what happened in my case is always I have been placed in very good teams, you know, and the teams, the people in the teams that I worked with have been really very pushy, and they never differentiated between you being a woman and you being a man. So they never differentiated the work based on gender. They thought both can do it. Mm-hmm. But one gender issue I faced was at my first company, when the ratio was 2:4,000. That was in Apollo Tyres. So they had hired women for the first time. And me and my batchmates were the first, you know, to join that company. And we had lots of attention, which I would normally love to have, but not that kind of attention. It was all wrong kind of attention. And that was quite a challenge. And that was also an experiment the company was doing to increase their diversity ratio. And it was quite a challenge to thrive in that environment. And it only added up to my understanding of how I can thrive in different environments. Apart from that, I don't think I had any psychological barriers as such to work in science and technology. And I think it also depends on the conditioning as to how we are brought up and in what environment we are brought up. And my father had always brought me up in an environment where he never differentiated between me and my brother and never told me that you cannot do anything. And indeed, we were brought up in a way, because he was from an Air Force background. So he treated me and my brother both equally, and we had to do all this stuff. So that never came to my mind. So apart from that Apollo incident, there really was never any psychological barrier. But that happens for many women.
So what do you feel were the key attributes acquired during your PhD which helped you the most in becoming a better confident personality coach?
Okay. You know, Vandita, because honestly, I never wanted to do PhD. It's not because that I thought I couldn't do it. It was more to do with the fact that I didn't want to do it. Okay. So when I started my journey, although I knew I would finish it, but in between there were pit stops that made me believe I can't do it. So in the process, I learned that I can do anything. If I can do PhD in metallurgy from being polymer science and technology, I think I can do anything. And also it makes you very, very, very patient. And it's, the attributes that PhD builds is that did develop in GE as well when I was working as a scientist. And maybe it got more sharpened is the eye for detail. And the ability to dig out information, you know, the various sources that you go and dig out information to support what you have found or maybe to find, to understand what you have found is either right or something needs to be done. So the ability to dig out information and the never giving up attitude, you know, it's like, things will not be smooth most of the time. Research is a very slow process and it's not very rewarding most of the time. And yet you have to keep going. So that is one thing that I learned. And I feel doing PhD is like a mini entrepreneurship. You know, you have your salary, but apart from that, everything else is totally uncertain. So it's like a mini entrepreneurship. It's like how you keep your mind that space proper.
I like that phrase of doing a PhD being a mini entrepreneur, because that's really what it is all about. So I have another question, or I would say I'm trying to understand, is that you worked long time to being a polymer scientist, then you went into metallurgy and doing a PhD, and now you are venturing into a totally different kind of work culture, I would say, or workspace. So what do you miss some part of being a scientist? And another question linked to it, that what did you enjoy most being a personality coach, which allow you to give up being a scientist?
Okay, so being a scientist, what I miss is, you know, whenever I met somebody, be it anywhere, and I told them that I'm a scientist, people didn't believe it. I don't know why, but they told me, you don't look like a scientist, okay? And everybody has an image of scientist as Einstein, whose hairs are all blowed out and his tongue is out. Everybody has that image of scientist. So I miss that. Now I cannot tell people I'm a scientist. So, and apart from that, I was good at what I was doing, but I thought whatever work I was doing didn't create the kind of impact I wanted to create. And that is why I shifted to something like this, you know. Being a scientist is something I will do for getting paid, you know. If someone is paying me, I will do it. But I will not do it if I'm not paid for it. So that is where I found my difference, you know. I'm not very keen on getting updated on what is the latest product that is coming up in my area of research or something. So that is where I thought that I can never be an expert in my field, because I'm not having that drive to update myself, keep updating myself. But when it comes to communication, I had that self-driven attitude that I need to work on my communication skills. I need to work to be a better speaker. I need to communicate in a way that I can connect to people. And all of this I was doing without being paid. And being a confident personality coach, now that I've trained so many people, and I've been getting video feedbacks from people, and they were like raving, you know, that they didn't have this simple understanding and how this changes their life. So that is where I think that when I am helping people to communicate the right way, because many people have a self-perception about themselves that they won't be heard because they are never able to speak, and people won't be able to understand them. So they get immersed into their own self-perception, which is negative. So opening up that window for them where they can come out of that negative space to a more positive space, and letting them know that this is what is not actually working for you, and this is what will definitely work, is something that has impacted people directly when I have been doing coaching, and that I have been seeing the results. So that has propelled me to do better, be better, and contribute more. That is not what is happening when I am a scientist. So that's why I switched.
Yes, okay.
Yes.
So you are in a phase where you are establishing yourself as a personality coach. How do you keep yourself motivated in such a time? And do you miss having a regular paying job?
Not really. When I was leaving my job, actually the last day of my job, and when I was returning home, I shut the doors of my car so hard and I was crying really bad in my car, you know, because not because I was letting go a salary, a monthly safe space, but I was letting go an identity that I recognized for the last 8 years. So I had to build up a new identity. It's not easy to let go the identity that you were attached to for so many years. So I had to build up a new identity. And that day, as I was crying and coming, I thought I should take a photo of mine, because this day is going to, maybe when I'll go and speak somewhere, I'll show this photo. That's, I will go back in history and remember this day that I had promised to myself that I will make this day count. Okay. So the thing is, now I said that story because even I wanted to explore that, how do I thrive in a space which is so uncertain and not having the comfort of enjoying a paycheck every month. I wanted to see myself thrive over there. So to your question, how do I motivate myself every day? You know, when I'm coming to this space, whatever work I have created for myself in the 2-3 months, including this interview, it's through networking. It's through posting my understanding of things on various networks. It's through connecting through people who I have already worked with. And many of them have come back to give me work. And once I receive something as positive, something like this, the one that is happening, it gives me a sense of, it gives, my intuition says that this is the right thing, it's going. Maybe it's not as happening as fast, because it's not supposed to. Things will take time. And I as these small little things keep happening, I feel that I need to be more patient. So every day I go back in the night and try to jot down what good thing happened today. And I try to make that good thing as big as possible, you know, rather than focusing on the bad thing. So that attitude of gratitude, if I may conclude it, it's the attitude of gratitude every day. I mean, I have made this a habit again, starting from COVID when it started and right after my accident, that I will list down one good thing that happened, however tiny it may be, and be thankful from the bottom of my heart for that, to, that it happened. So that is one thing that motivates me. I do not miss the 9-to-5 job. I do not miss the paycheck, because right now I may not be getting paid as I was, but what propels me is the kind of connection I create with people now, the students, the other people that I work with, and they are coming back to me for getting my coaching. So that's more than the money. I mean, money I could have received anytime, but this is something I would have never been able to do if I had been working as a scientist.
Yep.
It's not more motivation, but it's become a habit now, you know, because as I said, motivation is a pill the moment the pill is digested, motivation will die down. So it's more of a habit now that I have built up over a period of time in the last 1 year to 6 months. And I don't need motivation. I'm driven now. I'm driving my own car now. You know, I know driving now. That's what I would say. Earlier, I was not in the driver's seat. I was in the, you know, the person sitting beside. I was not driving my own car. But right now, I've decided to drive my own car. So I hope I don't meet any accident. So I'm not motivated. I'm driving it.
Awesome. Another kind of question our viewers may have is about, like, most of people are, even they think about doing something new, like they keep on thinking, but it never gets translated into something, like to even begin with. They never even start in doing or acting on those thoughts. So what advice you will give for anyone who have been thinking about doing something different than what they have been doing as a scientist or in any field, like they have been established, but they want to switch over?
So I would not give any advice, because I can only share what happened to me. And I think it happens to most of the people, is we have not been conditioned in that way to take steps or to venture into uncertain areas. So you have to prep yourself up. You have to prepare yourself in case if you want to take any such steps for you to see yourself differently. And the other thing is, if we are always stuck in the thought process that I want to do this, I want to do this, the thought process alone will not take anyone forward. You have to take actions. That's the only way, you know. You have to take actions. Even if you are in your job and you cannot afford to leave your job, then at least take some baby steps, take some actions, create some opportunities for yourself. And that's true with every entrepreneur. Any book you read, they have all taken actions. They were not stuck in that thought process. So the only, and if advice it is, then don't be stuck in that thought process. It will not be easy, because you will have to rewire your brain. But you can't be just sitting and thinking, aisa kar leta to acha hota. You have to actually do it. You have to do it. And it won't be easy. It won't be easy, because we are not having more and more of examples where people are ditching conventional routes and moving into unconventional ones. But it's changing now, and it will be changing more. So if you want to take that plunge, you can. And the other thing I feel is, also you have to decide whether you are an entrepreneur or an intrapreneur, you know. And the difference between an entrepreneur and an intrapreneur is their risk tolerance ability. When you are an intrapreneur, you need to have high tolerance for risk. But if you are an entrepreneur, which means that you're working for somebody, which means you're working in a company, but you need that net of paycheck, you know, which acts as a net, the safety net of the paycheck. And you can trade it off with your working as a corporate 9-to-5 things and other things that come with the paycheck. And if you're comfortable with that, then keep doing that. But don't go for entrepreneurship if your risk tolerance ability is low. It's a very treacherous path. It's very uncertain. And you have to have high tolerance for risk.
Indeed. Awesome. Yeah. So, Reema, personality coach involves a lot of people skills. And I believe you have had a vast experience of working with people from various backgrounds at Apollo, GE, and then CSIR laboratory. So did this, definitely I feel this helped you in becoming a better personality coach. Do you have some advice for building these people skills to academicians who wish to become a personality coach in future?
So I guess academic culture is already very exchange oriented culture, I feel so, because you are a teacher and there are students, And people who are good teachers, the barrier between students and teacher is, the barriers are very less, you know. Students can really communicate their heart out to their teachers, and the teachers also receive what the students have to offer. So if you want to be a personality coach, first of all, you have to be non-judgmental, because people develop a kind of personality not just like that. They are coming from a place where you have not come from. So you have to be non-judgmental about it. And the second thing is you have to be open to hearing everything, open to speak about everything. And the third thing is you have to be a really good listener, you know, because we are most of the time hearing, you know, and hearing is not equal to listening. I hear what is the words you're using, but I'm not able to listen to the feeling the words are projecting. So that is the difference between hearing and listening. So to sum it up, I said it's openness and being non-judgmental and having good listening skills.
Yeah, certainly. Like I heard a quote like some time back that like somebody wrote that, are you listening or waiting to speak? So
actually, I wrote that a couple of days back in LinkedIn. I had shared one thing. And this was a survey done by Harvard Business Research Organization as well, that, you know, the managers who are doing good as managers are actually very good listeners. But the managers who are not good listeners are not really doing that great when it comes to managing their team.
Yeah, that's true. So next, we would be interested to hear about your venture you're trying to build up and what future coming up. You can give little update, a kind of brief about viewers if they want to kind of get in connected to you.
Okay, so currently I work with people one-on-one and I do group sessions, and what I have done for now is I've worked for a staffing industry, corporate sessions I've conducted for them. And I have worked for students. I've given them trainings on leadership and professional skills. Recently, the one I finished. And I have worked with people one-on-one to take care of their professional needs, you know. I had one client who had a problem. The person was a product manager at an IT company. And person has a really good profile, and the problem was that they couldn't manage the other people around them for some reason and could not portray themselves the way they wanted to the higher management. So how could that be taken care of? That is what the person got connected to me for. And a couple of sessions down the line, the person got back to me and they were able to break through. So that was very good for me. That was a learning for me as well. In addition, I have been working with leaders from corporates in USA as well. And I have been providing services for professional appearance, which is in line with the leadership role that they portray in the company, because they have to attend many conferences and places where business meetings happen. And the person has to appear really credible and expert in his area of work. So those are the things that I have worked out with the person to give him a very professional appearance that makes mm-hmm. him look more credible. And moving forward, I am yet to understand what exactly is my niche, but these are the services I am offering to one-on-one professionals, to professionals in a one-on-one way, and to students I am giving trainings, and it has only been group trainings for students right now. And I have now a list of email IDs of like 500 students. Okay, so if I'm conducting anything, I roll out the emails to them. And being student fraternity, I conduct it at a very, very low price because I want every student to get benefited. So when I have higher number of numbers, I can go to as low as 100 rupees per session. Yeah. So that's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to build my email list.
Yeah, that's really good and it's needed, especially in India.
Yeah, and going forward, I am looking forward to making up my website by this month at max. Mm-hmm. If not, I hope I'll finish it up this month. So I'll have an official website and all testimonials and everything there.
Awesome.
And as you asked, 1 year down the line, I have set some goals for me and I hope to meet them, which is like reaching out to at least 2,000 people, you know. Connecting with as many IITs as possible so that I can speak and inspire people, because my last session at IIT, it's available in YouTube as well. If you just search with Dr. Rima Day, Campus to Corporate, it was much appreciated at IIT Dhanbad. So I want to reach out to as many students as possible in premier institutes and otherwise.
Awesome. I mean, I'm sure that student community and even the professionals who are trying to venture out, even to break the silos in the mind, you know, they will necessarily need such kind of training. So I have one question about this. Why do you call this image? Like, how it is analogous with, how do you explain about image and about a person? It's hard because generally people talk about personality and all that, but not an image. Yeah. What is for image processing or image? it's like more of a photo.
Exactly. When I actually ventured out and told people about image management, they associated with scanning or X-ray.
Even I was thinking, I must tell you, when I saw your BBC is an image consultant. She provides services for image processing.
Right. So right now, if I just take your example, Pavan, then you have this tikka. May I call it a tikka?
Yeah.
Right? You have this tikka over here. Possibly that portrays that you are quite attached to your culture and very deeply attached to your roots. Right? Mm-hmm. So that information is portrayed by looking at you. Right? Maybe I don't even have to speak to you. Mm-hmm. Right? You agree on that? So that's like a very tiny slice of your image that you are portraying, right? So image is about bridging that gap between what you are inside and what you want to project outside. There's many a times it happens that people, they look very good, but the moment they speak, you're like, no, I didn't expect this, right? And then it also happens that they don't look what they can deliver. But the moment they start speaking, you're like, oh my God, this person was so impactful. So it's about bridging that gap, you know, because we are living in a digital age. And it's called ABCD, you know, appearance, behavior, communication, and digital presence. All these four are taken care of. It matters a lot. And opportunities come to people who are projecting themselves the right way. So even if you are very good at what you do, but you have not been able to project yourself the way you are good at your work, then you might lose out on an opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
So it's all about creating impactful presence through your image so that when you get the opportunity, you just increase your probability of getting that opportunity. And when you get that opportunity, you deliver up to it.
Yeah, that's really interesting to understand about. I agree that ABCD is going to be, I don't know how many years, but next future in any sector, any job, even in...
In many companies right now, because we have moved to virtual world, there are interviews happening virtually, right? And people are not able to see you physically. So many companies go through your Facebook profile, through your LinkedIn profile, and maybe not Instagram, but they do check, because what you post again projects your likes and your dislikes and your orientation of thinking. It projects something. So I tell the students that if you have something which is quite messy on out there in the social media, and if you have interview or anything coming up, clean it up. Clean it up. We don't understand at that age, right? And that's the reason we keep sharing many things. But right now, that's also a part of your image. It projects about your thought process, right?
Yeah.
So it's easier said than being understood. The process is quite deep, and we have started image consultancy in India in the last 10 years, and it's now that in the 10th year that it is picking up so much in India right now.
Yeah, that's really true. You know, like people perceive what they see, and I agree. There is something called like social media history. So nowadays, like we maybe when we are 60 or 70 year old, we can go back and see that what we did in when we were 25 year old, 20 year old. And yeah. These now with the AI, a lot of companies are now, even I must tell you that U.S. Immigration Office ask your social media account so that they can go back and see you. That what was your behavior and perception about the world, so that they can screen you for being good person or bad person.
Right.
Yeah, so that's really coming up. Yeah, so I think with that, we kind of reaching to the end of our today's discussion. So viewer may want to reach out to you on different platforms. And before I come to that, so we have a couple of rapid fire round questions for you.
That is scary. Okay.
No, it's simple. Don't worry. It's really simple.
Because it's rapid fire, so whatever comes to my mind, that is the tricky part. That's what I'm saying.
Let's see what it comes. So,
because I'm not a very saint kind of a person. Okay.
So, which city do you prefer? It's Bangalore or Jamshedpur?
Both.
No, you have to choose. No.
Bangalore, because I have my initial schooling in Bangalore, and I had all my friends in Bangalore. My brother also stays in Bangalore right now, and I have lots of, you know, Bangalore is like my second family. So yeah, maybe Bangalore.
Okay.
Lots of good memories.
Yeah. Second one is, do you prefer traveling or food?
Traveling. You're asking, giving me options. I want to say both. Traveling and food, how can they be separate? They have to go hand in hand.
All right. So next one is that, do you prefer coaching or painting?
Did you do a research on me?
That's our job.
Okay. So that's again a tough question. Okay. I'll prefer coaching. Right now it's coaching.
Okay, awesome. All right. So with that, we'll wrap it here. And if the viewers want to reach out to you and connect you, what would be the best medium? And I'm sure they are going to reach out to you and ask you more questions.
Okay. So it's my LinkedIn profile. It's Dr. Rima Day. And on Facebook, I'm available as a confident personality coach again. And on Instagram, I'm available as Dr. Rima Day. And on Twitter, it's @ReemsDay. So any of the platforms. And if you visit my Facebook page, then I have my WhatsApp number there. And you can connect with me.
Awesome. So thank you so much for joining today. And it was really awesome to discuss and hear your story. And I'm sure your new venture, which is coming up, is going to help many, many people in India. back or and also across the world, because this is a life skill, universal skill used in anyone's life. So thank you again for joining us today.
Thank you so much for having me here, and I can't tell you how many times I want to tell you thank you, because this again provides me a motivation, you know, that I should be working more, I should be doing more, I should be improving more. So thank you so much for having me.